Mr. Khandelwal, the chairman and the CMT, and all the officials, I'm really honored to be invited here, and it's a great audience. I have a lot of friends. I have a lot of friends from HLL before, like Babu Thomas and Ayappan, and we were very close and working in Thiruvananthapuram Management Association. So certainly I'm honored to be here. I don't think I will take much of a time, and I was always wondering what to talk about to the young folks here. So I was, my secretary said that talk about system building, and that's what Anita suggested, or talk about the success story and all that. It's interesting that, you know, what will be the relevance for me, what I learned and what I did, perhaps, you know, in the present ecosystem, how it will be relevant, because things are fast changing. And but I can always learn from what we have done in the past. If you look at now, you know, it's all the age of disruption, you know, restructuring, consolidation. Wherever we go, we talk about that. We want to disrupt, and then we want to innovate, and we you know, and the creativity comes in there. So this is happening across the world, and the world is changing fast. Technology is also changing, you know, everywhere, and a good impact of technology also has come into in healthcare too. And when I was studying, I studied in Trivandrum Medical College, and I never had a CT. We never had a CT at that time. And subsequently, I went out, and CT all came. But at the same time, I couldn't write a CT, because my consultant's permission is required, because it's expensive. Only very few can be done. And from that stage, then I started writing as a consultant. And even now I'm a practicing physician, that's why. And now, you know, I think even the resident is writing the CT, you know, CT scan, and it has become a routine investigation. Same thing with MRI. While I was in the US, I wanted to do a PET scan for my son. And at that time, there were only two PET scans. One is in California, and the other one was in Boston. And it was so expensive, exorbitantly expensive, so I could not go and get it done. Even the appointment takes about 3 months waiting. And I could not wait for 3 months. So eventually I did not do it. But in my own hospital today, we are doing at least 8 to 10 CT, I'm sorry, PET CT, PET scan per day. So amazingly different world we are living in the last 30, 40 years of my healthcare career. But from there we have come, you know, if even the politically also, if you look at it, a lot of things have changed. Ultra-conservatism has come in, and you can see Trump, you can see Brexit, you can see Francois Philippe, you know, coming into France. So I think in 1869 or something, there was a wall, 1989, the Berlin Wall was there, and it was gone after 30 years. And now, after 30 years, the Mexican Wall is coming in. So a lot of changes are happening in political, you know, in IT technology. So same impacts are happening in the healthcare field also, and probably in the management. So healthcare management is nothing much different from, you know, other management, but probably a bit more complex. So, you know, we had a couple of private equity activities recently. And about 5-6 years ago, we had two private equities came into our organization. After their investment, they were good friends. One was a US-based one, and the other one was a Bangalore-based company. And they came in, and after we became friends, and then I asked them, why did you choose us, you know, KIMS, as one of the places where you wanted to invest? And the thing they said was that it is because it is a quality-focused organization. So I asked them why, you know, why did you say quality focused? And so they said they were studying due diligence, all that had been done. And so we follow the quality parameters, we follow systems. And so that's why. So I said, what about the numbers? You know, the finance numbers are the more important for any private equity. That's what the way I always see that. And they said, no, they were very sure about the sustainability comes from some of these quality parameters, and that is why they chose us. Now, they went out and they have been bought out by another company, maybe in the last 2 or 3 days, a couple of, you know, in the papers, it was there. One of the largest healthcare deal of $200 million had been just took place by yesterday or day before. And that happened in our organization. And a new company came, True North. And why did we choose? That's what we were looking at. And they're also very, very ethical based. And so we always have to look at some values outside the numbers. And that's what I always believe. And so if there is anything you want to take home from my lecture, that's only thing. I am still a very practicing clinician, and I still consider my people are the patients are my main focus. And all the rest of the things, towards the end, of course, everyone looks at the financial performance, but like in a, you know, in a Excel sheet. If you change these things in a very systematic, ethical, quality-based fashion, I believe that the last number of Excel sheet also should change. And that's what I always believe, because I only digest very minimal financial numbers just for existence in management. And my MBA helped for that, and that's how I survive. Today everybody talks about numbers, you know, that's why. Anyway, I'll just go through a couple of, on the right side, right? Yeah, oh, sorry. Oh. You should be careful. Okay. All right, this is a ADL view. We took it by using drone, you know, and we got a call from the police station that you cannot use drone. But already drone took the photograph, so we got the photograph and then said we will not use it again. So, so this is the photograph. So greetings from kids. Just a little bit about healthcare delivery, you know. And it is very complex compared to the manufacturing industry and maybe R&D and all that you are very much used to. You know, healthcare delivery is very complex. And when I say healthcare delivery, it is not only healthcare. What I mean is that how you deliver to the patient. It is a little bit important for you to know that, because there is MRI, every hospital today have big buildings. There is MRI, there is CT, there is doctors, and there are technicians. But putting all these together and what is really delivered to the patient becomes very important. And that is what I call as healthcare delivery. The reason is that an MRI can be taken by anyone, any machine, but it is important that you position the patient in various ways and take the various views. And then those views have to be manipulated in the computer in an efficient way. And that depends upon the technician, and then it's being read by the radiologist. And so it should be an MRI radiologist. So it should be an MRI technician trained. It should be an MRI radiologist who reads. And that is the way it is conveyed to the consultant who is looking after the patient. And then he has to process it. Obviously, I used to just ask for an MRI. Today, I cannot ask for an MRI because I will ask for an MRI. More than that, I will say, I want to visualize this man's gallbladder. And so the radiologist decides what is the best investigation. Maybe he will say, his ultrasound is better. You know, why do you want to waste time for MRI or money for MRI? So even the investigations have grown up so complicated and complex that an ordinary physician and internist like me even cannot decide what is the investigation which is required. And that should be decided by the experts in the investigation. So that is the way it becomes complex. So the delivery depends on, every scan center will take an MRI. But the question one has to ask, or you have to ask, and because you are the people who are submitted to this, and you should demand for quality, and you should demand for patient safety. And then only the technician will deliver that, the doctor will deliver it. And then the standard of care will improve. And because you said that the system building, you know, it was very hard, you know, see, Keralites, I tell you that in my opinion, you know, traveling across the world quite a bit in the last 40 years, and I will say that we are one of the most enterprising fellows, and we are highly intelligent and highly informed. But we have a very, our mindset is quite a little bit different, and probably highly socialistic, highly questioning, you know, with a questioning mind, which is good in many respects, but we system. And when I go to, when I went to work in Aramco, or when I went to work in UK, it was extremely, you know, system based. So I didn't have any room to maneuver. If I want to change something, first you follow the system. And I am sure you are doing the same thing over here. And just now, the officers were saying that everybody punches here, or everybody has the biometric, the punctuality is great. I was delighted to hear that, you know, we also do in our hospital the same thing. So so the systems are, if there are no systems, Keralites are very, very difficult to be managed. And, you know, from general, I don't know, but I have lived all my life in Kerala or outside. And so other states, I don't know. And we have a tendency, even the doctors, first disobey and then ask questions and beat the system. I think that mindset, if we change, we are wonderful people in this world. So I don't want to say, you know, these are all, you know, I talked about healthcare delivery, and all these have to be perfected just to get everything in a refined way so that your healthcare will be in a successful manner. What we did in KIMS, you know, we started in and that's when I also came over from our side. But we were planning with my family, my brother especially, who are from Mr. Najib, and Dr. Vijay Raghavan, who's a close friend. So we all together, the first thing I would say that what we developed was a teamwork. And that teamwork started working in from 1996. And so 6 years or 5 years it took to accomplish what we wanted. So you should have a determination to start and what you want to start. So in the very beginning, we were very clear that we have a mission, we have a vision and all that. But to say that, the most important was the financial aspect. Of course, not the financial aspect of getting money, shares and all, that was a uphill task. But more than that, how the doctors have to be paid completely white money. So today we don't talk much of white and black after the demonetization. But I'm talking in 2002, doctors who joined cannot have any black money at all. And all of them, completely and totally, it will be through accounted money. And at the end of the month, a check will go to their bank account as their fee. So there is nothing more, nothing less. Perhaps even Apollo at that time, Apollo came into existence about 12 years before us. Even today, even Apollo can't get into that system because they didn't start on the right track on day one. And many doctors build their own and they go. Second thing is no practice at home. Except some charitable institutions probably you can visit. There is no practice at all, non-practicing doctors and full-time working. So these two were really a determined effort from the whole team. And I feel that was one of the main pillars for our success, especially as we went along. So the financial discipline. We never, even before demonetization, we never had, dealing with money so much in big amounts given as cash at all. I have never dealt with, even if I want to give charity, I write and give a check, and never on cash at all. And so that was helpful in a way, because when the political donation comes, I will say that I can give only by check. So many of them will go away, and but now they also have learned the trick of getting the check. So so you never win. So these are the most of the administrative things which we practiced. And mainly I mentioned about the financial discipline. And I want to just say about one word about the IT. We are not completely successful in doing the complete automation. What we want is that no paper at all used. I wouldn't say no paper, sorry, I take it back. It's a less paper situation is what we want. Because according to our court and according to our government, we should have some amount of hard copies, especially for legal purposes. So we still keep it. If somebody dies in an accident, we are supposed to keep it for 10 years. And so we have got some storage for that. But otherwise, we have pretty much now 7 years or 8 years, our OP, we don't have a record at all. Completely, it is automated. And since last year, all the departments have not become totally paper-free, and all of them, but about 60%. By the end of this year, the whole hospital, in all the centers, in the SBUs, we want to make it completely automated. In the sense that doctors write their notes after seeing the patient on the computer, and by Wi-Fi it will be transferred to the main server. And of course, then we are looking at the cloud and all, because storage is a major area. If MRI I want to store, there will be a lot of digital imaging is coming. So there's a lot of problems are coming, but at the same time, it's a challenge, but it's a very, very nice way to go forward, and I don't think there is any way to go backward at all in this area. There's only one thing is that patients may complain that doctors may not be looking at them, and instead of that, we are all typing. So we have changed the computer to the side now, and so the patient will sit just across, and you have to talk to the patient, and then meanwhile enter, and 24 hours it will kept open, and then you can enter, and after that it is sealed off. Then you cannot correct at all. If you want a correction, it should be an addendum, and that is how. So the court likes it, and even when recently we went to the court, they know that it cannot be corrected, and they were very, very appreciative about that. There is one area where still, you know, we have not completed the training and development. I was working in Aramco, and one organization I always was proud to work with, and this is this oil company. And, you know, when they, so many seminars, so many meetings, just like this, and when you do this meeting, I really appreciate that you are inviting every month a person to talk about their experiences. So this is a wonderful thing, you know, the organization is doing for you. And initially, I was also very skeptical, every month meeting. And then I started enjoying, and then I started experiencing the value of it. And then I had been sent to US for executive management programs and things, and which I really further enjoy. So please understand that what this organization is doing it for you is that without your knowledge, you are really improving. And I have 2,900 people working in Trivandrum alone. And to do that, it's a Herculean task. But I try, and I still have to accomplish many things there. Then another thing which is very difficult and I have found is that teamwork. And doctors are, you know, good people, and they often very intelligent people. They are come after a lot of you know, studies and qualification, but somehow teamwork is not ingrained in their gene. So what happens is that they will not discuss about a patient condition to a colleague. So we started what we call as medical boards, not for routine cases, but any complicated cases or any complicated procedure. People should assemble together, 2, 3, 4 concerned consultants should assemble together with a medical superintendent or with me or whoever is in management, and do a discussion. And then the relatives will be called in and will be told that this is the way we are going to manage, these are the problems we anticipate, and this will be the cost which is likely to happen. And I think most of the people appreciate that, because they know that they got more than a second opinion by people getting together. And also it has a fringe benefit. Otherwise what happens is that if something goes wrong, you know, other doctors will be saying that, yeah, you know, that's not the way to do. We always have a tendency to blame the other guy. Whereas if all of them are sitting together and is documented and each one signs there, they cannot say that, no, this is not the way I said. And so that helps in many ways. So these medical boards are good examples of teamwork. It took about 10 years for us to build up that. But today, it has become a second habit and a routine. So I think it was a good thing to do. On the clinical side, probably it may not matter much to you, but there are a few things which, all over the world, the best way to practice is protocol based. Okay, so if there is a protocol for a cancer, there is a chemotherapy. I won't be able to remember, even the medical oncologist won't be remember all the medicines, all the doses, and the medication errors happening in chemotherapy for a cancer patients are dreaded. Even in the best hospitals in the world, it has all happened. And people had myocarditis. There are stories which I can say maybe another time. But the important is that if you have a protocol written, and there are international protocols, but we follow if there's an Indian protocol, otherwise we follow international protocol and by FA, American Cancer Society or American, Gastrointestinal Society, etc. And therefore, we are very protocol-based, and that can standardize the outcomes, standardize the results. So a doctor coming from US or a doctor coming from, Delhi, both of them join work here, but they have to follow this protocol. So I have no worries about patient safety. Otherwise, one guy will be doing that, and one guy will be doing this, and that is not possible. And so many, in fact, we call it KIMS technical memoranda for the scientific matters, and the non-scientific matters we called KIMS policies and procedures, and that's where KPP. And we have about 700, policies and procedures and KTMs. Evidence-based medicine is a very important thing which we practice from day one. There should be an evidence for me to give you an antibiotic. And antibiotics, I say about antibiotic because it's a most abused thing. And so we just prescribe without a second thought. Maybe patient demands a little bit, but it is our duty to convince the patient that you don't need an antibiotic, in my opinion. So just wait a couple of days and see how it is. And and there should be an evidence, we were just talking with Dr. Sayana. Even 30-40 years ago, if there is a sore throat, we used to take a swab and we send it for culture, and that comes in 24 hours, and then only we start an antibiotic. But that's not a practice anywhere done, neither in Kerala nor in India. And it's very easy to take a small swab from the throat. And doctors do not want to do that because as if, oh, I know what antibiotic to give, or I know there is an infection. You can never know a strep throat whether it is, unless it is cultured. And if it is cultured, it has to be properly treated. So that's what, in short, evidence-based medicine. I don't want to talk about medicine here. And we have also incorporated performance matrix to the patient, to the doctors. That means whether they are following the protocols, whether they're using the electronic medical records, okay, and whether they are privileged to do a procedure. Every doctor cannot come and do a surgery unless a particular doctor, even if he's the best specialist in liver, he should be privileged to do that particular procedure. So credentialing and privileging is a system which had been appreciated by all the international accreditation agencies. And so because you said about the systems, it was very, very difficult, and that's why I concentrated on that. And I just want to make you understand that. And then there will be always a wall developing between doctors and the administrators. And what happens is that administrators are scared to go to the doctors, and doctors are always demanding, and doctors look down upon the administrators to some extent. And so what we thought that in various committees and all, we put them together as participatory management. And so that paid off a lot. And so they understand each other. and they tried to work together. So a teamwork developed there also. We bought CT from the very beginning. In the CT scan, if you want to really break even the cost, you should be doing at least about 7 to 8 CTs per day. And so, or even a little bit more, maybe 8 to 9. But we were doing only 1 or 2 CTs. So I had you know, calls from practicing doctors in the community and said that, you know, doctor, you know, said, how are you doing in CT? I said, I'm doing 2 to 3. So you are losing. I said, I am terribly losing. So why don't we try to make it 10 to 11 per day? I said, you are welcome, you know, if you refer patients is great. And then he said that there is something called a reading fee. I said, don't worry about it at all because I have excellent radiologist who will read and send you the report. So he was puzzled. So he said, so you don't understand what I am talking about? I said, I do understand what you are talking about, but I have no intention of giving a commission for a CT. And whichever hospital I have taken over, everywhere, even the inside hospital doctors and outside doctors were paid commission for CT. And it was, you know, recently we took over a hospital in Calicut, Kims Al Shifa. It was rampant. So it took a year for me to stop totally and completely to convince doctors that you cannot get a commission for ordering CT either. So today, Kims does not pay for one doctor any commission for any investigation or for any patient referral entirely, you know, and here as well as in the GCC countries. And so my answer to the question is that ethical business can survive in Kerala or anywhere, provided you are convinced about it. So your conviction is important. I talked about quality. Quality is my passion. So I will talk about it for hours. And quality, after various parameters, everything is here. That is will be boring for you. But you need a stamp, you know, that you have quality, for which you have to invite international or national agencies. So we were the first one to be accredited by National Accreditation Board of Health, that is India. And even before that, we got the Australian accreditation. And so we always, and every, it's not one time and we are using as a marketing gimmicks. Every 2 years they come for. So this year NABH comes, and next year ACHSI comes, and the interim survey the year after, and then the full survey comes. So our staff will be vigilantly watched and scrutinized. And that's why we keep the accreditation going, at least from national and international. You talked about teamwork. By the way, somebody asked me who is my, you know, NRI, sorry, you know, my purchase head. And this is NR Pillai. And he is our supply chain. And I was talking, and he's not only a good purchase head, he is also get paid for posing for all these, he is a model too. So the others are our doctors. All right, so this is where you are all coming, I think, and see the millennials, right? And so, yeah, if you look at that, people, you know, who are born in this area, and now people, the youngsters here are all born here. So the HR, the previous HR we were talking about may not be very relevant today. And probably in the coming couple of years, you know, because the youngsters think quite different. So there's a big generation gap. So what I was thinking and what you are thinking is quite different. And it is not easy to handle the youngsters, or rather we handle them differently. And so is a challenge. I do not want to it. I think the IT companies and most of the young organizations are looking for young people to work, and so everyone is trying to make their organization younger and younger. And sometimes I wonder whether it's the right way or not, but whatever it is, it is the way in the world is going. And today I read in the paper in Manorama that where a housekeeper is paid 8,000 rupees, a techie is paid only 6,000 rupees. Did someone read that? Yeah. So I felt bad about it. But it is interesting that how we have to manage the young minds of tomorrow. Yeah, so some common characteristics of the millennials, and you can look at it, you know, there is a lot of, you can't expect them to be like before. They have got their own way. They may not respect you unless just because of your position of managing director, but if you deserve the respect, I'm sure they will respect you. But if you demand it, probably you will not get it. You know, so because that's the way the young mind, because they're challenging. You know, they did not come the same routing as I came, or even my next generation came. They came from a different level, and so they think differently. But we have to adapt as managers to that, rather than we expect them to adapt to us. And that's in the. See, their ideologies and digital dependency, social media, and so on and so forth. But, you know, I also want to bring your attention. You know, is it the right way? Because we started living longer now. Every year, 2 to 3 months of the lifespan is increasing. So, In another, 10 years or 15 years, there will be many, many more centurions in our own country. If you look at Okinawa in Japan, that is one of the places where the maximum longevity of life is there. People started now living 125s over there. And there are, actually, one of my friend's mother is going to celebrate 100th birthday next week. So it is increasing. So when it is increasing, this is a book, The 100-Year Life, written by, and if somebody want to read, it is available at the Bonan bookstore. And it's a nice book to read, because what will, you know, probably Dr. Kandaival, should think about it, because what will be the age you are going to recommend for retirement? So usually it is 60, maybe it is 65, and then, you know, after 65, if he's going to live 35 years, the government has to give pension for, 35 years, right? If he's going to live 100. So how are we going to handle it? So it is, and also this another thing is that, you know, 65, 70, 75, and all very productive age, and they have got a wealth of experience. And they don't think like the millennials think. They think still more conservative. So is it a mixture is better? And should we all terminate people at superannuation age, 65 and all? It's a question, especially for private organizations. And I'm sure your HLL also, very much, even though it's semi-public, right? Yeah, but still it has got so much of a private organization flavor, or a corporate flavor. So this is a nice book, I recommend you to read, go through that. And my time is almost over. And one of the critical success factors we look at in any business is, one is financial, second is growth, and so forth. So this is the just the growth, I just wanted to base everything on my organization, and that's why. So this is how we came up. This was, I don't know, you might not have been born, many of and seen the marshy land. As a little story, I had a friend who was working in Brunei, and he was an orthopedician, and he came on a vacation, and I came from Saudi Arabia. And so he came and said that, he brought me in this area and said, that was about 30 years ago, and he said that, why don't we buy 25 acres of land here? So I said, which land? This water, it's completely marshy and underwater with all the weeds on that. So so he said he doesn't have the enough money. So if we put the money together, and he's still working, and he had the vision. I know if I bought 25 acres at that time, probably I would have started a medical college or something better. So I didn't go for it. I didn't put my money. The same place after 10 years, I might have paid 10 times and got it. And at that time, still it was marshy, but not as marshy as it was. That was the land we bought, and then came up. The growth is an indicator of success. We had been fairly there. Automation, I think it is a indicator of success, because I heard Ram Charan's, he's a management guru, his lecture the other day, and he was even recommending that we should spend about 15% of our turnover for IT. And so I was amazed, and of course it's mostly for an IT company might have been talking, but even then I felt that even we should spend more on IT, probably that's the way to go. Though Ram Charan is a big guru in these things. And this is, I just wanted to put it up for interest. Is there an age for an entrepreneurship? I started, in my early 50s. And I feel that there is no age at all. And you should be trying at any age. And if you persist and persevere in your philosophy, you should be successful, and God willing, we always say. Okay, this is another thing people ask me. Are doctors good entrepreneurs? In fact, if you look at the doctors have the quality to be good entrepreneurs, and they're intelligent, they have specialized, spend a lot of time on education. They deal with crisis every day, because crisis is, patient's crisis. And decision making is very good, because these are qualities you need as a manager. And they have to take critical decisions. And all that is their, and so they are ready to be managers. But something that is bothering them is that they cannot come out of the box. And their thinking is also narrowed down. The more you specialize, probably he thinks only about the nose for an ENT specialist, and he cannot think anything beyond that. So that out-of-the-box thinking is that they're lacking. But many, many doctors are coming out as managers now, which is good to see. And this is what I like always, Kerala is known for a lot of platform speeches and presentations. And after all that is over, nobody bothers. Politicians, we know them well. So I think if you want to make a change, you be the change, and then the world will follow you. And that's all. Thank you for the time. I hope a little overdid it. And sorry about that, but if there are any questions, I'll be very happy to answer. And if I confine to the medicine a little bit, because that's what I have done, and that's where my expertise is. But I like management. I love management now, even though I loved medicine. Nobility of the profession is a very important thing. And when we talk about nobility, many people just sometimes ask, now doctors are not keeping the value system, and they are degenerating values and all. So I often answer, even the ministers, the bureaucrats, so they're all there, your sons, daughters, or son-in-laws, or whatever it is. And so if you keep the value system, they will also keep it. So they are corrupt, they can't get anything they want to. They go for all kinds of nepotism, favoritism, and all. But the doctors do that, it becomes a sin. So that double standard is not nice. Thank you. Otherwise, I will keep talking. I think, good questions, why doctors are changing? I told you that I didn't have any CT scan and all that, and then now when I see patients, I examine top to bottom. I make a professional diagnosis. I may do few tests just based on that one. Mostly I will be right, but there is a higher percentage of mistakes can happen because of that. US started the system by which the investigations became more and more important. But if you look at it, there are two factors. One is patient demands. So patients' demands, even though the affordability factor remains low, they want to make sure that the doctors do not make mistakes. So the doctors have gone a little bit defensive. And so they do not examine the patients as they are expected to examine. They ask a few questions, they do not go in the systematic order, and they do not examine in the systematic order, okay? I have examples very interesting, but I don't want to waste your time. And so, one way is that, and then the medico-legal cases are increasing now. And so, doctors are again becoming more defensive. So what they do is that they depend much more on the sophisticated investigations which have become expensive. But at the same time, I should also say that there are situations where these investigations have definitely saved patients and which doctors would not have found out. I can just say an example. I had a doctor friend working in Dubai. He wanted to go to US and he came here and he had just a physical checkup. So in the physical checkup, we found that his wife has a tumor of the kidney and by an ultrasound. If the ultrasound was not done, if you ask me, why did you ultrasound? I have no answer. But it was done as a part of your physical checkup. And she didn't have any complaint, but it was caught at the right time and the kidney tumor was removed. It was 7 years ago. And she's, fine and dandy. She went to US and she's living happily still in Dubai. And so there are so many examples I can quote, small aneurysms, people come with a headache. And if I don't do a CT, urinary course, I will not do a CT. But a couple of times you come again and again, then I may have to have a suspicion that if I don't do a CT, and a third person, another doctor does, or God forbid it ruptures and you have a problem, they will say that I went and saw this doctor in Kim's and see that I ended up with a paralysis. So that should not happen. So when you go to a tertiary care hospital, that is the end of the road. That is the end of the road, and the doctors feel that they should be accountable for everything, and that's why they do more investigation. Believe me, it is not, please believe me, that no doctor in KIMS have ever been told that you have to make money by doing investigations. ever. In fact, on the contrary, I always say that please look at the people and whether they can afford, and all the costly investigations should be explained to the patient, and only if they can afford, we should do it. The second factor about the cost, say we are perceived as a costly hospital, but if you have come there and walk around, and we don't have any customer groups. Actually, there is no patient groups or a market segmentation. You know, you are a new marketing manager, just joined today. So we don't have any market segregation or segmentation. If you look at it, you can see that 60% of the people pay out of pocket there. About 20% is by corporate and the insurance. And 10% is paying by I know they are international patients coming from outside. About 10% of the patients are paid by either our corporate social responsibility or NGOs. So we do see all the entire entire group financially patients, but we have got a reputation or a bad reputation that we are a costly hospital. You could compare, and I'm not here for marketing games at all, but comparatively speaking, that is not correct. But I'm not taking any attempt to correct it because it has to be corrected by itself. You know, I cannot just hold a placard and say that, no, it is not as costly as. But one thing I tell you, when sometime you look at cost, and quality together, you have to go to the quality place because otherwise you will end up paying much more money. A fracture, if it is not fixed in the properly, in the first place, then you will have more problems and more problems, and it has to be refixed and all that. So your life and your sufferings it much more. So this is a trade-off between these two. And it will take some time really to consolidate and settle unless the regulations are coming and every quality becomes a compulsory thing in every hospital, not only private, in government too. And mind you, when government is still shying away from private care, 70% to 80% of the patients are seen in private care even today. This is what I told Rajiv Sadanandan the other day. So he's a little bit against the private hospitals. But I tell him, this is the fact, and so you have to accept the fact. Instead of shying away, join hands and see how we can innovate for the masses. Okay, I think things will change with the new innovations and new things coming, and a lot of things. For example, now we are talking about air pollution. We were just talking about air pollution. I wanted to do a seminar on air pollution. Probably the electric cars are coming. The driverless cars are coming. All of you have driving license today. So maybe after 5 years, you don't need a driving license. The cars will come in your doorstep. You don't have to own a car. Probably many companies like Ford and all that will collapse. Only small good cars are coming, and you sit in, you reach there. No parking lots are required. So things may improve. Air pollution will be no more. So in the same way, healthcare also, big hospitals are not, big buildings are not the answer for the masses. I think the delivery of care should, I'm against, I have no choice, that's why I'm going to build another building over there. But I think 15 years time, things should change. And only thing is that, are we ready for that? And that's where our mindset has to be ready. Instead of being negative, we should look at positively. Not only us, the policymakers too. Actually, home healthcare is a new thing which is coming up, and we are also going into it. Home healthcare for the masses will be much more affordable than coming to the hospital, not only in terms of money, but also in terms of time. Why should you come and wait for a physiotherapy or take a blood, spending 1 hour? A lab technician can go to your house and take. It may not be for you, you are young and agile and no problems, but for your mother, your grandmother, you know, certainly they need help and we can go and help. So I'm looking at developing, you know, home healthcare in a big way. But about the practice, home practice, you know, there is a problem and that is why we don't allow. And in certain situations, we ask them, they can go for a charitable institution and some charity if they are doing at home, we don't stop them. But they have to have an undertaking that it is a charitable. Otherwise, what happens is they will not come time. You see, in the morning, from I can quote many examples. They start their practice like 7 o'clock in the morning. By 10 or something will they finish. They will be coming to the hospital by 11. And they cannot see. And by the time, the patients who are in the hospital will be very irate. They are neglected. Complications can come. So our doctors are accessibility and availability are the main important factors in delivering healthcare. And that way, I feel that doctors better not to practice because what happens is that their retention will be completely gone. So we, you know, politely I'm saying reasonably pay well so that after the hospital hours, they should spend time with their family. They should go out for a movie. Not that until 12 o'clock you see patients at home also. And they should enjoy the life. And that will make them more refreshed for the next day. And so, but there are other models we can always try out. Please understand that you only know the hospitals and the doctors whom you are confronting. But there is a number of agencies who are part of the stakeholders who are part of the healthcare delivery. And they are equipment companies, pharmas, you know, pharmaceuticals. And there are, you know, many more. So what happens, you know, even your suture, this morning I was saying, the suture, if I can buy for a lesser cost, I can deliver the care for a lesser cost. Okay, so it should be indigenous suture we should be buying from HLL. But we have certain parameters for quality. Is it CE approved? Is it FDA approved? And so there's a vendor selection process. And so if that can be, you know, satisfied, then we will buy from them. Okay, so when we go for a quality, you know, product, and that the cost also increases. And that is why the, you know, it is especially evident in case of chemotherapy and especially anti-cancer medicines. And but anti-cancer medicines, we cannot take a chance, okay? I'm telling you that, you know, while I was in Calicut, there was a study in the Calicut Medical College. There was a lot of typhoid. And typhoid at that time, the best drugs was chloromycin. Even though it is toxic, it was great in effect. But that time, you know, we gave chloromycin and none of these typhoid responded, so we had to go for costly medicines. Finally, the government investigated and it was found out that the chloromycin, the so-called chloromycin got out of the generic drugs, did not have chloromycin. You know, if it is some like supposed to have 100 milligram, it had only 5 to 10 milligram. And no typhoid bacilli will be killed by that. So therefore, then we go for, you know, Glaxo or, you know, branded companies. And when we go for branded companies, definitely the quality is assured, but the cost is high. So it should be a public-private participation really to reduce the cost. And in chemotherapy, I'm telling you that government has to interfere. And the cost is high. And definitely it is why we face a problem. We have some foundation like Touch HLV Foundation where we subsidize, but we cannot afford to subsidize to everybody. But government has to interfere with the pharma and see the quality is maintained. See, when they reduce unilaterally reduce the price, the government, I am scared because they will also reduce the content of the, you know. And so you may not be getting, or your patient may not be getting the right doses, and then it will really shooting on your own feet. So this is the problem. So we have to understand the affordability of the people. Insurance or co-payment systems have to come in. And all the gimmick, political gimmicks will not work. So if you are, I really want to congratulate the our PM and the first national health service formula, I mean health service portfolio, they published about 2 weeks ago. It was excellent. I read it from page to page, touching all the public health, all these issues, and even spending 5% of the GDP for health. I don't think it will come to that very soon. We are now spending only 1%, even though political manifesto says that they are supposed to spend 2%, but they are spending only, even if they spend, because India is a big country, so even if we spend 2% or 2.5% of the GDP, we will be way ahead in our healthcare, you know, for the masses. So I agree that we have an affordability factor, and there is no single answer for that. But if we join hands with the corporates, with the social corporate social responsibility, even HLL, I know HLL is doing, even IT companies, they are all have CSR. All these have to be used for a insurance policy for non-affordables, and or make co-payment system, so that you pay some, and then you know these people pay some, or the government pay. So government, if there is a will, there is a way, and that is the way we have to look at it. I don't have an answer for you, but I agree that many of the drugs are overpriced.